وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه، وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. We are still continuing to tackle the issue of good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And last time we delved into an area that would help us practice good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the area of human rights. What did Allah give us of rights? And it raises a question with that, which is, are those rights conferred upon us by governments or authority, or are they divinely dictated given rights? We spoke last time about the right to life as one of the basic rights of every human being, Muslim and non-Muslim alike. And we spoke about the right to earn your living and to protect your dignity and your right to work wherever you want to work and to roam the earth without boundaries, without borders, without limitations. These are some of the basic human rights that we spoke about last time, and we gave the evidence as to why is it enshrined in the Quran that those rights ought to be protected. Today we're going to continue to the rest of the basic human rights. We know that under dictatorships, a police state, no human has any right, because it is up to the dictator to say who has rights, who is elite and protected, and who is to be violated. In a police state or a dictatorship or a royal rule, only the royals have the royal treatment. Only the elites get the elite treatment, but the rest of the people are not treated the same way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to clear this issue, He told us that the problem and the indictment and the sinfulness of mistreating people does not only belong to the Pharaoh or the dictator or the king or the emir. It goes all the way down to the soldier that is abusing the people. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا كَانُوا خَاطِئِينَ. Pharaoh and Haman, the chief of police or the army, and their soldiers were wrong. They were wrong to kill people. They were wrong to persecute a minority. They were wrong to target with abuse certain segments in their society. So we understand from this that the dignity conferred upon us as humans and upon all human beings goes beyond the bounds of faith, what you believe or what you don't believe. And we know this even in the practice of the Khulafa al-Rashidin. We know the story of Umar ibn al-Khattab calling down from Egypt to Medina the ruler of Egypt, Amr ibn al-As, because his son, not himself, but his son aggressively attacked a Copt, an Egyptian who happened to be a Copt. And Umar al-Khattab called him and he punished him, he whipped him and his son, and he told him, when did you ever enslave people that Allah has created free? متى استعبدتم الناس وقد خلقتهم أمهاتهم أحرارا. So we have to be careful that when we demand our rights from those in authority, that those rights are divinely given by Allah, and when we ask for those rights, they are not doing us a favor to agree to give us any of these rights. Also, we mentioned quickly last time the right to choose your faith, whether you want to believe or you don't want to believe. In the Quran, in Surah Yunus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the everlasting principle and rule, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا. If your Lord had willed it, every human being would have turned a believer. And then he raises a rhetorical question, questioning the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. Would you then, O Muhammad, coerce people to make them believers despite their free choice that Allah has given them? So we have to be careful that we Muslims should understand that our role is not to convert people. Our role is to invite people, to educate people, to give them the right on us to learn what Islam is about. But it is not on us whether or not they accept it or not. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ عَلَيْهِمْ حَفِيظًا. We have not sent you over them as a keeper, as a keeper over them. وَمَا أَنْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِوَكِيلٍ. And you are not an agent in authority over them. No, the Prophet ﷺ cannot force anyone, let alone any Muslim. We cannot and should not seek to coerce or force or convert anyone despite their free choices. In fact, we should protect everybody's choice to believe whatever they believe and to worship Allah whatever they want to do. Also, the Quran gives the ultimate and free choice to every human being. مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعَاجِلَةِ عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا مَا نَشَاءُ لِمَنْ نُرِيدُ. He whose desire is exclusively in the interest of this life and what it has to offer, we will give him what we will regarding this life. But then, ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَا لَهُ جَهَنَّمَ يَصْلَاهَا مَذْؤُومًا مَدْحُورًا. And then he will be sent to the blaze of fire for choosing a life that is not worthless, that is worthless, is not worth it, and for violating the invitation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that's up to Allah. Remember, the punishment for people's choices of believing or not believing is up to Allah. But if you are a Muslim and you accepted Islam, then if you violated, there are certain violations that will have to apply to you as a Muslim. Of course, there are violations that apply to all, like the hudud. These apply to a Muslim as well as a non-Muslim, so long as they accept to live under the authority and the protection of the Islamic State, then the rules there will apply to anyone, like killing any person, whether the killer is a Muslim or non-Muslim, then the rule of law will have to apply. So Islam does not draw a distinction to advantage or disadvantage its followers. When it comes to applying the law, everybody is subject to the same law. But when it comes to faith and choices, everybody has the same right again to choose to believe or not to believe. وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةِ. He who desires the hereafter, and his focus is on winning in his faith, in his relationship with Allah. وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا. And he strove to earn his path to his faith the way it should be. وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. While he is a believer, فَأُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ سَعْيُهُمْ مَشْكُورًا. Those will be fully rewarded for what they have worked for. Also, there is a right between the ruler and the ruled. And I want to give this some extensive explanation because it does matter to much of what is going on in our ummah today. And that is the right for the people's opinion and the people's choices. We know from the reading and the study of both the Quran and the Sunnah and the biography and the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he never charged his community with anything that would cost them blood or treasure without consulting them. I'll repeat this again. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never charged his community with anything for which they pay either in blood or treasure or limb without consulting them. He always would consult the community whenever he sees that this would be their blood to pay, their treasure to waste, their limb to sacrifice or expose to danger. And even after he consulted the people and got their opinion in the Battle of Uhud, and some of them violated his instructions and caused a very difficult and serious defeat for the Muslims and a loss of life that amounted to about 70 of the closest and most courageous companions of the Prophet ﷺ, still after that and after the Quran chastised those who were in violation of the commands of the Prophet, here comes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tell the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَمْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. In a typical dictatorship, when the dictator consults, if he ever does, with his leaders and community leaders, and then they violate his command, he puts them to death because they cause the community a lot of damage. But not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He doesn't hold military trials even for his military forces, but the Allah tells him, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. If you were harsh-hearted or uneasy on them or not soft-hearted with them, they would have dispersed and left you behind. They would have gone away, they would have left Islam, they would have left the da'wah. فَعْفُ عَنْهُمْ. So forgive them. فَعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ. And ask Allah to forgive them. وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. And continue to consult them in the matter. What is the matter? The matter here is what matters to them as a community. What matters is called the matter. So the Prophet ﷺ continued to consult them further even after the defeat that they had contributed to. So this is the ummah's right, the community's right on its leadership to consult with them in matters that cost the community either treasure or blood or limb. The community must be consulted and they ought to speak freely when consulted. No one should speak other than their mind. People should not give up the right for truthful and honest consultation to the leaders, because it is that bond. The bond between the leader and the led is the leader will be honest and the led will equally be reciprocally honest in their advice and in their commitment and in their obedience to their leaders. So this is the right to respect the choices of the ummah. When the Prophet was consulting with the youth in Medina before the Battle of Uhud, it was the youth who said, let us go, we have to go, we cannot wait, we should not let them come to Medina, we should go out to them. And the Prophet saw this as a disadvantage, not an advantageous position to take, to stay exposed with his army outside of Medina. But he went down with their consultation because they were very strong, they felt very strong. So he left his opinion and followed their opinion. So when the ummah has a majority in one direction, the leader cannot say, your opinion is a consultative opinion. As some scholars would argue, that the opinion of the consulted is always consultative. That only applies to individuals and a small group. But when it is the majority of the community that is insisting that their interest is in one direction, the leader doesn't have a choice but to comply and oblige to their choices. Also, individuals, groups, and the community in general, they do have the right to speak their mind whether they are consulted or not consulted. When it is a matter that they regard as serious, they have the responsibility to speak, and they also have the right to speak. We know the story of a man that the Quran called a man. وَقَالَ رَجُلٌ مُؤْمِنٌ مِنْ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ يَكْتُمُ إِيمَانَهُ أَتَقْتُلُونَ رَجُلًا أَنْ يَقُولَ رَبِّيَ اللَّهُ. A man spoke up what he believes, even though it was both very dangerous for his life at that moment, because Pharaoh had just threatened to kill Musa and those who are following him, but it was also very seriously dangerous for him because he never declared his faith before. So the first time he spoke is the time that got him recorded in the Quran as a man. And a man here is not a description of masculinity, it is a description of manlyhood, that he was manly in his position, and he was manly in his expression, and he was manly in his bravery to expose himself to be killed right in front of Pharaoh, and he was not afraid. So that is both a duty and a right. When a single individual feels afraid of his government, it means that the government is too oppressive to allow people the right to speak up. And without this, the community doesn't have goodness, neither does the leadership. Abu Bakr and Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhuma, when they took leadership after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they spoke to the community openly and they said that you have no goodness in you if you do not speak your mind to us, even if it is against our wish, and we have no goodness in us if we do not hear you out and listen to you. This is the contract between the ruled and the rulers, that the ruler obliges to allow, not only allow, but encourage and solicit and support everybody's right to speak up and to speak truth to power. That should not be a challenge at all for the Muslim if he is living in a community that is ruled by righteous leadership, in a society whose rulers are seeking truth, not seeking just power for themselves. We also get the story of the two men, one who went to warn Musa, telling him, Musa, the people are conspiring to kill you. وَجَاءَ رَجُلٌ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ يَسْعَى قَالَ يَا مُوسَى إِنَّ الْقَوْمَ يَأْتَمِرُونَ بِكَ لِيَقْتُلُوكَ فَاخْرُجْ إِنِّي لَكَ مِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ. He knew that Moses was followed, and he was followed to get his neck. So he was accused of murder. Capital punishment is waiting for him. But he, as a man, as a believer, he did not see that his risk is worth the neck of Musa. So he goes. He risks his life, and he risks his own neck to protect Musa alayhi salam. This is a human right, but in this case it also is a responsibility to come and run and to protect. وَجَاءَ رَجُلٌ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ يَسْعَى. He came from the other end of town running towards Musa, knowing that Musa is being tracked down by the authority. But that did not stop him from speaking his mind. We also read the same in Surah Yasin, when an ambiguously mentioned couple of prophets came to the people. They denied them, And a man also came who was described as a man to tell his community to listen to their prophets.
وجاء رجل من أقصى المدينة يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين.
He said, oh my community, follow those messengers. These people are messengers from Allah, follow them. He knew that almost everybody was in denial and rejection, which means he was also exposed to danger for his life, at least his limb. But again, he does not give up his right and his responsibility to run all the way to declare his position, saying to them, follow these people, they are messengers of Allah. And that's why you see the Quran magnifying its appreciation of those types of positions, saying, من المؤمنين رجال. Among the believers are men. Men, not masculine men, but true men. Not males, but men, which means people who take a manly position. And that is not only true for masculine men, but it is also true for females who took manly positions, like the wife of Pharaoh, who denounces Pharaoh in his own palace and prays to Allah to disregard whatever she has in this life and to build for her a house in paradise. إذ قالت رب ابن لي عندك بيتا. She didn't say a palace in paradise. Oh Allah, build me a house with you. Because what matters is with you, not the house. رب ابن لي عندك بيتا في الجنة ونجني من فرعون وعمله ونجني من القوم الظالمين. So she took a manly position and Allah chose to pick her as the example for all the believers, men and women. Men and women are given an example in a woman that took a manly position. We do have another story of a woman that took a manly position in a very unfeminine situation. People in the Battle of Uhud were fighting to defend their life and their religion and their community. And here was a woman that was fighting all around the Prophet ﷺ, about whom he said, I never looked to my right, nor did I look to my left, nor did I look ahead of me or look behind me, except that I found Umm Imara defending me. How could she be on four sides of the Prophet ﷺ, fighting with her sword? That is a manly position. But definitely we know that many of the men were scattered around and the Prophet was exposed, were it not for her defending him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he mentions her and he recognizes her for her courage and for her bravery and for her manly stand. So to take a manly position is both a duty and a responsibility. To speak your mind, to speak truth to power, is part of your right as a human being. Also, to fight back against oppression and the oppressors by all possible means until oppression is gone. A Muslim should never accept oppression as a way of life, because once they do, it turns that they end up losing not only some of their lives, some of their positions, some of their honor, some of their dignity, but the end result is they end up losing even their faith. So the ultimate position that a Muslim should take against oppression and oppressive regimes and tyrannies is to stand up even if it is his life on the line. You cannot fight back without expecting the risk that you can be killed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا لَكُمْ لَا تُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And why don't you, the believers, fight back for the sake of Allah, which means according to His guidance and for His own purpose, not for expansion, not for aggression, but to fight according to His guidance and for the sake of helping the helpless men, women, and children. The description here is of an obliterating tyranny that's killing everybody. As Pharaoh used to say, اقتلوا أبناء الذين آمنوا معه واستحيوا نساءهم. Pharaoh was much more merciful than some of our contemporary tyrants today. Pharaoh asked that kill those followers of his and their children, but leave the women alive. He didn't want to blemish his hand with the blood of women. Definitely for his own purpose, he wants to enslave them. But still, he did not give himself the license to kill women. He prohibited his soldiers from killing women, unlike what we see today. Men, women, and children, young and old, are fair targets for the tyrants of today. But that's only because the community is not taking seriously what the Quran is saying, that you have to stand up to push back against tyranny and oppression if you want to keep whatever is left of your dignity and of your community. The Quran speaks against tyranny in the story of Pharaoh in Surah Al-Qasas, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Pharaoh has really risen himself up above everybody else. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ. He is too arrogant. He put himself higher and above everybody else. And he made his community into divisions and sects. وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شَيْعًا. Those who are with him and those who are against him. Those who accept him as God and they obey him and kiss his feet no matter what, and those who want to listen to Musa and want to obey Allah and want to worship none but Allah. وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيعًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded people to stand up for Pharaoh and not to accept the fear campaign that he spread around their life and their property. And he commands Moses and Harun to go to Pharaoh. What they are going to do? To speak truth to power. What kind of power? It's a power of tyranny that doesn't know limits, doesn't know respect, doesn't have laws, and doesn't abide by anything. Limitless power. So Allah tells him, go. They say, we are afraid. He says, no, I am with you. I see and I hear. I hear what's going on and I see. Don't be afraid. قال لا تخافا إنني معكما أسمع وأرى. Three words. معكما, I am with you. I hear and I see. Those are the three words that when Moses and Harun took them seriously, they got the courage to go and face up to Pharaoh. Just by the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because these were not for them words. Those were words that come with the power that matches what they say. It's Allah speaking and they gave it the appreciation of the source. This is not another king's promise. This is not another power intervening against Pharaoh. This is Allah telling them, don't you be afraid. لا تخاف. And then he gives them those three assurances and they accept it. So they go. We know the story of David and Goliath. A prophet was asked by the children of Israel, if you want us to stand against Goliath, these are two powerful people, assign us a leader, give us a leader. So the end result, David, a young man in the army of Talut, killed Goliath and he became himself the king. And Allah gave him wisdom and knowledge and leadership. So a young man, do you know what a young man is? 17, 18, 19, that's what it is. That's what it is. Usama ibn Zayd, when he led the army, he was 17. We think today and treat 17-year-olds like kids. Come on. They were men. And in their army, there were men older than they were. So we have to start thinking the way our forefathers used to think and act. To think like a great ummah. An ummah that has the power of its conviction, the power of its faith, and the power of its commitment, and the power of practicing what they believe. This is what gave our forefathers the power to go into very, very difficult and serious situations unwavering. They were not shaken, they were not reluctant. And here is, in that situation of David killing Goliath, that Allah says, كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِئَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. How many times did a small band of people who are weaker and less in number defeat a larger band of enemies by the power and the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So brothers and sisters, we need to look at whether or not we are exercising and practicing both our duties and our rights, and if we are taking those rights as God-given rights. Because if we think that our freedom is a government-given gift or privilege, then we are lost. Because what Allah gives us, He expects us to receive it with power and conviction. خُذُوا مَا آتَيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةٍ. Take whatever we have given you with power, the power of your conviction and the power of your obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think I will stop here because the time is running out. But before we just conclude, I want to say that our commitment to Allah as people of faith has to go beyond us looking at us as just needy, poor people who only remember God when we need something. If you don't think you need Allah Himself, then waste no time and ask for anything else. Because if you have Allah, you need nothing else. And if you're missing Allah, nothing else will help you. And that is what it takes to have good manners with Allah. That you acknowledge that He is the greater one, greater than everything. Then everything else comes next. He is our priority. He is Allah. And when we say Allahu Akbar, we must mean it practically in our life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us His greatness and help us comply and be obedient to Him. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. Brothers and sisters, it is quite unfortunate today that many of us believe that to stand up for justice or community dignity or rights is just the responsibility of the few, or the scholars, or those who don't have anything to worry about. No, it is everybody's responsibility, and it is everybody's duty. And if you want to deny them, if you want to deny those rights as yours, then at least remember that among those rights are many that also come as a responsibility. So you cannot escape being a Muslim. You cannot run away from your duty. Even if you discount those as rights, then you have to embrace them as your duty as a Muslim. The only thing that distinguishes our ummah from other umam is mentioned in the Quran. كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس. What made you the best of nations? تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر. That you enjoy the good and forbid what is bad. Denounce what's bad. Stand against what is wrong. Whether you are standing against yourself, your parents, your family, your kin, it doesn't matter. Stand for Allah and stand for justice. كونوا قوامين بالقسط and كونوا قوامين لله. Both in Surah Al-Nisa and Surah Al-Ma'idah. We have to stand for justice and we have to stand for Allah. When you stand for justice, be witnesses for the sake of Allah. When you stand for Allah, be witnesses for justice. كونوا شهداء كونوا قوامين لله شهداء بالقسط and كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله. So in both cases you're standing for Allah for justice in both cases, and that is not just a group responsibility, because when one only stands on behalf of the community, it's an easy neck to chop. But when the whole community stands up, it's a difficult task for any tyrant. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the courage and the bravery to stand up for our rights and to comply with our duties and responsibilities. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا، غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا هما إلا فرجته، ولا كربا إلا نفسته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا غائبا إلا رددته، ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته. اللهم اغفر لنا ولأمواتنا وأموات المسلمين. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين، وأحسن عاقبتنا في الأولين والآخرين، واحشرنا مع خاتم النبيين، مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله. إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.